So why do we have a tradition to eat fried foods on Hanukkah? And the real answer is that because the miracle happened with oil, the pure olive oil in the menorah, to commemorate that we eat these foods that contain oil. But my friend said he believes that the Greeks believed in the perfection of the human body. They performed their sports chiseled, muscular, bulging in every spot. And we as Jews are going to show it's not so important. So we're going to eat the donuts. We're going to eat the latkes. We'll develop some padding. That's just a joke. So back to the story of Hanukkah. The Greeks did their utmost to stamp out the Jewish religion. And it was at that point that a group of people who were extremely, extremely zealous for their Judaism, they said, we're not going to let this happen. And they were a group of Hasmonean priests. They were not trained in the tactics of war, but they said, we're not going to take this sitting down. And they trained and they picked up spears, and arrows, and swords, and they went to fight against the mighty Greek army. And miracle of miracles, they won. They pushed the Greeks out of their land. They re-entered their temple, which had been defiled, debased, and desecrated, with idols strewn all across. The Greeks knew that the Jews did not like pigs, and they would take pigs and kill them and leave the carcasses all across the temple. And that's how we found our holy and beloved temple, in this state of disarray, disrepair. And we wanted to kindle once again the menorah, which had been out of function for a little while. And we needed pure olive oil that still had the seal of the high priest. And we searched, and finally we found one small flask of oil, which still had that seal unbroken. But it wasn't a lot of oil. It was enough to last for just one day. And the process of pressing more oil would take a full 8 days. But we said, we're going to do our part. And we poured the oil into those little cups of the golden menorah, and we lit it. And that oil lasted not just for one day. It lasted for a full 8 days until we were finally able to process and produce more oil. And to commemorate that, we celebrate by lighting the menorah. Every night, we light a candle to fulfill the basic obligation. It's enough to light one candle every night. If you want to really go above and beyond, what you do is you light one candle on the first night, two on the second, three on the third, and so on and so forth, where you add an additional candle every night to clearly signify what night of Hanukkah it is. Last night, when you saw four candles burning, you know it's the fourth night of Hanukkah. And there's another element of how we celebrate Hanukkah. In the morning services, which I do quite early, we sing the songs of praise known as the Hallel. We give thanksgiving, praises to God for bringing about this miracle. So we give prayers and we offer songs. That's how we celebrate Hanukkah. To contrast, the other rabbinic holiday was known as Purim. It's still known as Purim. And Purim was in the era between the first and second temple. It preceded the story of Hanukkah. In the Persian Empire, there was a man, a wicked man by the name of Haman. And Haman, just as Hitler, we believe they share similar roots and origins, wanted to obliterate, to exterminate every Jewish man, woman, and child. And we prayed and we fasted. That was our initial response. And then Haman met his early demise when Queen Esther, who was a secret Jewess, she was the queen of King Ahasuerus, she was able to bring about Haman's end. The way we celebrate Purim is slightly differently than how we celebrate Hanukkah. On Purim, it's a day of feasting. It's a day of celebration, of merriment, even of drinking. It's the only day in the Jewish calendar where there's actually a mitzvah to imbibe in spirits and wine, things like that. And it's a festive day of a real physical celebration. So Hanukkah we celebrate mostly with matters of spirit, songs, and praise. On Purim we celebrate in a more physical way. And the question is why? Why, when they establish these means and methods of celebration, do they institute that Hanukkah is a spiritual form of celebration? And on Purim, it's a more physical form of celebration. Why is that? And that brings us to Source 3. Source 3 is from the work of the Chafetz Chaim, Rabbi Yisrael Meir HaKohen of Radin. He lived at the turn of the 1800s to the 1900s. He lived in a small Polish village known as Radin. And he wrote a commentary to the Code of Jewish Law, which is studied very much today. Let's take a look at source 3. It says, Chanukah is celebrated by giving thanks and praising Hashem, as opposed to Purim. This is still on page 1. As opposed to Purim, which is celebrated by joyously feasting. The reason for this difference, and here's where he gives that answer, why they chose different methods of celebration. The reason for this difference is that in the times of Purim, our enemies sought to destroy us physically. So let's take a look at the Purim story. Haman, did he care whether or not you were a practicing observant Jew? If you said, okay, I'm going to give up circumcision, would he say, okay, you could live now? He didn't really care. Just like Hitler didn't really care. I recently saw, I'm going to digress for a moment, an incredible idea. And it speaks to Jewish unity. And it says that we as Jews share so much more in common than we do apart. And we need to feel the sense of oneness. And we all have different ways that we practice. No one's looking down at anyone else for the way they choose to practice their Judaism. There's more than one way to heaven, I believe. And the saying that I heard recently that resonated with me was that Hitler didn't differentiate as to what denomination of Jew you were. He didn't care. Jew was Jew. We need to feel the same way. It doesn't make a difference what denomination we are. We're all Jewish. So in the times of Haman, in the times of Hitler, they didn't care about your practicing of religion. They tried to destroy us physically. That was their goal. Continues the Mishnah Berurah, the Chafetz Chaim. He says, had we abandoned our religion and adopted theirs, they still would have killed us. Turning to page 2. It was our physical bodies which were in danger and subsequently saved by Hashem. Therefore, we celebrate in a physical way. That's how we celebrate Purim, by feasting and drinking. In the times of the Hanukkah miracle, the Greeks sought only to assimilate us and force us to give up our religion. The Greeks didn't want to kill us. They wanted to assimilate us. They wanted us to become Greeks, just like them. We were saved from a spiritual danger, and therefore commemorate the miracle with a more spiritual celebration. So that explains the difference as to the two rabbinic holidays. Hanukkah, they sought to assimilate us, to destroy our religion, not our bodies. And therefore it's a more spiritual celebration. We're celebrating what was threatened. In Purim, they didn't care about our religion. They didn't care about our observance. They wanted us dead. The threat was against our bodies. It was a physical threat. Hence, it's a more physical celebration. So this is all very clear, documented literature explaining the two methods of celebration. The question that troubled me when I was younger, I remember I still had this question years ago when I was still a single man, going back at least 13 years. The question that bothered me was, okay, we've explained why we celebrate the holidays differently, but if you look at the initial Jewish response of the times, there's a drastic difference. In the times of Hanukkah, when we were threatened spiritually, we were threatened with assimilation, they wanted to make us Greeks, they didn't want to kill us. Our response was we picked up weapons of war, spears, bows and arrows, swords, and we went to go fight a physical war. Yet, in the story of Purim, what was the initial Jewish response? We fasted. We assembled in synagogues and we prayed. We repented. We didn't initially go out to fight until Haman already had his downfall. So why this difference, this disparity in the Jewish response to the threat? To the threat of assimilation, when they endanger our religion, we went to go fight physically. When there was a spiritual threat, when there was a physical threat, then we fasted, we said, God, you're in charge, help protect us. And he did. Why that difference in approach? And here's the theory that I developed when I was younger, and I believe that some of my teachers agreed with it. When there is a concern of assimilation, what does assimilation look like? There's a smiling Greek guy knocking at your door, and he says, I'm your neighbor, let's be friends. I want to invite you over to my holiday party. We're going to be worshiping the Greek god Zeus. It's going to be a fun celebration, lots of drinking, lots of eating. Be neighborly. Let's be friendly. That's how it all starts. When that didn't work, they made edicts and laws that forbade the Jewish practice. But it's a very friendly approach. You know, when our forefather Jacob had his encounter with Esau just a few weeks ago, when you count it by the Torah portions, he had fled from his brother who wanted to kill him. Remember, Jacob took the blessings from Esau. I believe he took them rightfully because he bought it for a pot of lentil soup. But Esau didn't quite see it that way, and Esau wanted to kill him. And Jacob fled to his uncle's house. His uncle was a man named Laban. It was his mother's brother. And he spent about 22 years in his uncle's house and then a few years on the road. And he finally has his encounter with Esau, and he's scared. He's scared for the welfare of himself, of his family, his young children. And he prays to God, and he says, "Please save me from the hand of my brother, from the hand of Esau." That repetitive seems redundant. From the hand of my brother, he only had one brother. That's Esau. What does it mean, from the hand of my brother, from the hand of Esau? And one of the commentaries explain that Esau and his descendants can have two approaches, and they have traditionally throughout our history have had two approaches how to attack the Jewish people. One approach is when they come like Esau, the warrior, the fighter, the villain, where they try to harm us physically. That's what he means, save me from Esau. But they also have another approach, which is just as, if not more, effective. That's the brotherly approach. That's the warm, smiley approach. Come, assimilate. Practice like we practice. Give up your old archaic customs. Don't you believe that's no longer relevant in the year 2000, almost in 17? Right? Give it up. That's the brotherly approach. That was the approach of the Greeks. And there we are at risk, because if we don't fight, if we don't clearly label them as the enemy, we are likely to fall prey to that smiling, arms open, waiting for that embrace. We need to be the ones to show they are out to harm us, and therefore we needed to take up weapons and fight. When it came to the story of Purim, we were threatened by an enemy that was physically superior to us. The entire Persian world was given license to attack the Jews and take their property. And we realized we were outnumbered. There we turned to God to help us, and he did. And that's the difference of approach that we had between those two holidays. If we're threatened spiritually when they try to assimilate us, we need to be the ones to make it very clear, this line of demarcation, you are not our friends. We'll go to war, we're going to fight you. When they make it clear that they are not our friends, as they did in the times of Purim, in the times of the Nazi era, we don't need to make that demarcation. They make it for us. And therefore we turn to Hashem, because naturally we're not going to win those wars. We turn to Hashem and ask for his support. One more idea. When the Jewish people re-enter the temple, they find just one small jug of pure, ritually pure oil. And they feel compelled to use only ritually pure oil. And they're concerned, how are they going to have enough? And they try, and it lasts for 8 days. And my question is, friends, why did they feel compelled to have only the ritually pure oil? The rule is, this is a technical law. The law is that if most of the Jewish people are ritually impure, as they had been having gone to combat, then because most people are in that status, you would be allowed to use oil that wasn't ritually pure. Why was it so important to them? And here's perhaps what the answer is. You know, the Greeks tried really hard. It wasn't a coincidence. It wasn't random that all of the jugs of oil had been defiled. The Greeks made a point. They made an effort to try to do that. And the fact that we were able to find one jug that remained untouched was this little glimmering light. It was this sign of hope that God was there with us. And our response was, if God already told us he's here with us, then probably this is going to work with this pure oil. There's no need to rely on that leniency of using oil which is not pure. Because sometimes in the darkness of night, could you just imagine, the Jewish people finally won the war, and now they march on into the temple, and they're hoping to be able to just find it pristine and pure and beautiful. But it's not. It's a mess. It's ransacked. And they finally won the war after, you know, hardship. They lost, the Jews lost. They lost soldiers in this war. It's told of one of the Maccabees named Yonatan. Yonatan the Maccabee, Judah the Maccabee's brother. There was this elephant. The Greeks would take elephants and plate them with armor. You can just imagine how powerful that is. An elephant plated in armor. There's no way to attack the elephant. And many Jews were falling to this elephant. And Yonatan realized that the elephant is only vulnerable from the underbelly, because that wasn't plated. And he ran beneath the elephant, took a long spear. And even though there are those who might be offended by cruelty to animals, but when this elephant is being used to attack you, killing human beings, you have to. You have to end the elephant's life. And Yonatan realized the only way to do that would be to attack the elephant from underneath and spear it from underneath. But if you do that, it comes down on you. And that's what he did to save his brothers who were fighting together with him. He ran underneath the elephant, he speared it, the elephant came down on him, and he gave his life. That reminds me of another Yonatan who shared a similar experience and fate in the famous Entebbe raid, where terrorists kidnapped, they hijacked a plane, an Air France plane, and they flew it to Uganda. And Idi Amin, who was the president of Uganda at the time, was no friend of Israel, and he gave safe refuge to these terrorists. And the terrorists segregated Jews and non-Jews, and they let the non-Jews go, and they forced the Jews to stay as hostages, demanding release of other terrorists. And the Israelis sent in a commando unit. And it was a fascinating story. Idi Amin drove a black Mercedes. And the plan that Israel had was, they are going to send in commandos. They used Hercules transport planes to transport this Mercedes to Uganda. They are going to impersonate Idi Amin, his black Mercedes. They're going to drive it right up to the checkpoint, and that's where they will begin their attack. In Israel, though, they only had this model Mercedes in white. So that day, they sent a white Mercedes to the paint shop, and they painted it black. And they began their attack, and the guards, the Ugandan guards, didn't see this coming until the black Mercedes, they were ready to salute Idi Amin, and out of the backseat, the Israeli commandos opened fire. And they rescued just about every single hostage, and only one of the Israeli commandos was killed in combat, and that was the leader of the mission, their head, who was Yonatan and Netanyahu, Bibi's brother. And he also fell in combat that day. So that's another Yonatan who gave up his life. Going back to the Hanukkah story. The war was not won without casualties. Yonatan died. Others died. It was a prolonged battle. And they finally win. And they enter into the temple and they're so excited, they're exuberant to be able to once again re-enter their holy sanctum. And it's littered, desecrated. If you just imagine how dark that moment must be. But then they find the little flask of oil, which was a miracle in its own right. The fact that it remained unbroken, untouched, that to them was a little beacon of light. God saying to them, I'm here with you in this dark moment. And that gave them the courage to say, you know what? We're going to try using only the purest of oil. We see the same message, by the way, in the Joseph story, which is now the topic of the Torah readings in synagogues on Shabbos. They're reading the story of Joseph. And Joseph was 17 years old when he was kidnapped by his brothers, sold as a slave to a caravan that was making its way down to Egypt. And the Torah tells us what the cargo of this caravan was. And I'll read that with you. That is source 4, page 2, source 4. From Genesis chapter 37, verse 25. And it says that right after the brothers had sold him to the Ishmaelites who were passing by in a caravan, they sat down, the brothers sat down to eat bread. They raised their eyes, and behold, a caravan of Ishmaelim was approaching from Gilead, and their camels were carrying different kinds of spices, heading down to Egypt. The Torah tells us the cargo. What were they carrying? Well, they were carrying spices, and it gives even more detail. Lotus and balsam, these were the spices that this caravan was carrying. And we don't believe the Torah gives us extraneous, unnecessary details. If the Torah is telling us what the cargo was, it's important for us to know. But who really cares? Why is it important for us to know what they're carrying? And here Rashi, the classic commentator on the Torah, tells us why it's important to know. Source 5 says, Rashi, why does the Torah publicize the nature of the merchandise of the caravan? And he answers, to inform you of the reward of the righteous. These caravans generally transported tar and petroleum. So the Arabs, the Ishmaelites, even back then, were in the oil business. Tar and petroleum, not much has changed. And those items have a foul smell. If you've ever gotten gasoline on your hand when you're pumping gas and a few drops get on your hand, it's the worst thing because your hand will have that odor for a good few hours to come. Doesn't smell good. And had they been carrying their standard cargo, Joseph would have had to sit on the caravan on the way down to Egypt with this really foul-smelling cargo. But now that Yosef would be joining, Hashem orchestrated that the caravan should be carrying items with a pleasant fragrance so that Yosef shouldn't suffer from the bad odors. I just want you to try to conjecture up the imagery in your mind. Joseph's state of mind at this moment. He had a really special relationship with his father. They were really close. 17 years old at the beginning of his life, slaves didn't usually come back home. It wasn't part of their schedule. Trips back home didn't exist. As far as he can tell, he's never going to see his father again. His brothers, who he knew didn't like him very much, but he probably didn't realize to this extent, just betrayed him, sold him off to some uncertain fate. Where will he be heading? He's not even sure. Do you think he cared very much? He's sitting there going, ah, it smells like lotus and a little balsam. Potpourri. That was the last thing on his mind. He didn't care. You know, sometimes when you're in a black mood, you just, you know, you want it to be gray outside. You want it to be thundering. You want darkness. It should be in sync with the mood that you're feeling. You don't want this shining light. What does that mean? That in order that he shouldn't have to smell the foul odor of tar, he didn't care. I promise you, he didn't care what it smelled like in that caravan. It could have smelled like tar. It would have been fine with him. What's the message here? And there are two approaches. One approach, which I've heard, is to tell you that God never gives a person one iota more than they're meant to experience. And if Joseph was meant for whatever reason to suffer this level of suffering, it was not going to go beyond that threshold even one drop. But I heard a deeper explanation that resonated with me that I remember clearly because I had a friend back in Israel. I lived in Israel for a good number of years, which was beautiful. It's absolutely beautiful. Whenever I go back to visit, so I lived there for almost 9 years. And my Hebrew is, as they say, kacha kacha, not so good. And whenever I go back, I speak to the taxi drivers, and I tell them in Hebrew, Ani tayar, I'm a tourist, and I start to speak to them in Hebrew. And they're like, wowee, you speak like that when you're a tourist? They're like all impressed. I know if I tell them that I lived there for 9 years, they're going to yell at me, and this is how you speak? Just like that? So when I was living in Israel, I had a friend who had a baby. And the baby was born with some pretty serious medical complications. And this was their first child and their new parents, and it's just this really difficult hardship that they went through. And they couldn't give the baby his Brit Milah, his circumcision, on the eighth day, as is traditionally done, because the baby has to be healthy enough to do that. And probably a few weeks or even a few months after the baby's born, finally they have the Brit Milah, the circumcision. And he gets up to speak. And it's an emotional moment. His baby's finally well enough, and thank God the baby today is fine. He gets up to speak and he tells a story. And the story that he tells is of a young boy who needed to have surgery, minor surgery, nothing serious. But the boy's terrified. This hospital with all the machinery, strangers, people he doesn't know, they're doing all these tests, they're putting this band on his arm, and they're making it really tight, and they're taking it off, and they're giving him some shots, and he's scared. But what gives him the security to go through the day is that the fact that his father is right there by his bedside, holding his hand throughout this entire ordeal. But then the moment comes when they need to wheel his hospital bed to the operating theater, and his father's not allowed inside. And then the young boy loses it. He starts crying hysterically. He's scared, he's frightened. Then he peers up, and as is often the case with an operating room, there are two circular windows that are part of the doors that swing open, leading into the operating room. And he sees his father's eyes peering in through those windows. And at that point, the young boy calms down. He knows that his father can't be physically with him in the room, but he's hovering nearby, watching over him. And my friend said that throughout his hardship that he and his wife went through, they had some really rough days. But no matter how rough those days were, each day had a moment where something unexpected went right. And they saw this as God sending them a little light, a little message of hope, saying, this may be really hard, but I'm here with you. We're doing this together. And that gave them the fortitude to go through it. I believe that's the message here with Joseph. Joseph is at the darkest moment of his life. It doesn't get worse than this. He was thrown in jail later on, but I don't believe it was as bad as this moment. And the cargo that's with him, spices, things that smell great, which is highly unusual. The Arabs deal in tar and petroleum. That was God sending a little beacon of light, a little message of hope, saying, Joseph, I know this is rough. There's a purpose, though, and I'll be here with you. That was the symbol of the spices, and that's the symbol as well of that little flask of oil the Jewish people found when they re-entered the temple. It was a dark moment for them. After winning the war, they realized they have a large job task ahead of them. But God says, I'm here with you, don't worry. I would like now to explore a topic which is related, and it is the most famous, the most commonly asked question in the entire literature of Hanukkah. The question goes as follows. We celebrate Hanukkah for 8 days because it was a miracle. The oil that was meant to last for only one day burned for 8. So we celebrate for 8 days. And the question that I put forth to you is not my question, it's the question of Rabbi Yosef Cairo. And you can see the question on page number 3. He was born in the year 1488. He passed in the year 1575. And he is buried in Israel in the mystical city of Tzfat, up in the northern Galilee region of Israel. And his question is that if the oil was able naturally to last for one day, and it burned for 8, then how many days of miraculous burning do we really have? So,
seven.
All right? 7 days. So why is it that we commemorate 8 days? It's only 7 days of miracle. The holiday of Hanukkah should be only 7 days, not 8 days. And I'm a firm believer, by the way, that the idea that the Christians have Christmas for 8 days, I believe it's a playoff off of Hanukkah, which is 8 days. We had the holiday first. Had we made Hanukkah for 7, they would probably have a 7-day holiday also. So why is, my kids would answer this question very simply. They'll say, Abba, you guys give us a little treat and a little present every night. That's why they made it 8 days and not 7. It would only be 7 days. It's this beautiful little custom we have. We light the candles usually at about 5:15 in the evening, and every member in the family lights, and my 4-year-old is really excited. This is the first year where he's allowed to hold the candle by himself while he lights his candles. I'm hovering right next to him. But in years past, I held his hand while he did it. This is his first year where he's allowed to hold it independently. He's very excited about that. So after we light, we all sit on the couch and we sing the traditional songs of Mo'oz Tzor and Haneiros Halalum. And then we give the kids treats like candy bars, and we'll give them some presents. And it creates this very positive association. Now, I don't actually believe here, I think the sharing went the other way. I don't think that it's really a Jewish tradition so much to give gifts on Hanukkah. I'm guessing that was created by the Christmas holiday. That's my feeling. But you know what? It creates a very positive association with the youth. They look forward to it, and why not? A present is a good thing.
It was a tradition to give money.
Yes, gelt. Hanukkah, yes, gelt. Yes, it's a good thing my kids don't know about that one.
But then you don't buy gifts.
It's true. So it's either or. You're saying if you're spending the money, either you give them the cash or you give them the gift and it all equals out. Okay.
But not a lot of money either, right?
It was a small amount of money.
No, every day you get some.
Yeah, but a small amount, right?
Depends if your grandmother is rich or not.
in Israel, they call it Dimei Chanukah, nachon? You know, so that's the Hebrew way of saying Chanukah money. What's that?
It was the best holiday. We collect money.
Okay, so let's explore some answers to this question. The question, I believe, is a fair question. We should only celebrate 7 days if the miracle was only really 7 days and not eight. The Beit Yosef himself gives three answers, which are more technical in nature, but they work. Let's take a look. So the first answer he gives is cited on page 3. And I'll read with you where it says, Beis Yosef number 1. So they realized there wasn't enough oil to last the 8 days, and that it would take more time to produce additional oil. So they divided the oil in the jug into 8 parts, and they poured 1 part of the oil into the menorah on each of the 8 nights. That small amount lasted the entire night. So his first answer is they took the 1 measure of oil and they divided it into 8 parts. And on each night, that small part lasted the entire night. Therefore, each day, each night was actually a miracle. The difficulty, and that's what I wrote as my point to ponder that I had with this answer, is that what exactly were they thinking? Did they did they know that a miracle would happen? If they didn't know that a miracle would happen, then you are not going to be using the prescribed amount. There is a prescribed amount. There's a minimum amount of oil that you need to use in the lighting ceremony in the temple. It's not just, you pour and you try to, estimate. It was very exact. It was the amount of oil that they figured would be needed to burn on the longest night, which we're at now. We're just about at the longest night right now in the year. That was the amount of oil they used every single night. And that's the amount they had to use. So the difficulty that I had with this answer was that according to their estimation, they wouldn't fulfill the mitzvah, the commandment of lighting the menorah on any of the nights. Because if you're only using enough to burn for 1/8 of the night, you're not going to fulfill your obligation. Do they know that a miracle would happen? Were they relying on a miracle? Maybe. Generally, we don't believe that we rely on miracles. So that's just a question to think about his first answer. His second answer is as follows. It's on the first night and on each of the following subsequent nights, whenever they poured oil from the jug into the cups of the menorah, the jug remained completely full. The level of oil in the jug never went down. And therefore, on all the nights, there was a miracle. There was a great sage in Israel known as the Baba Sali. We've heard of the Baba Sali?
Yeah.
Great sage. And he had, in Israel, I'm getting nostalgic about Israel, I'm talking a lot about it today, but there's this drink that's very popular with the Sephardic community, and I liked it very much. It's a very strong, licorice-flavored liquor called arak. Sweet, strong, about 40%, and it's very popular in the Sephardic community in Israel. The Baba Sali was the leader, one of the leaders of the Sephardic Jewish community in Israel, and they say, I've never seen it, so I can't corroborate it, but they say that he had a bottle of arak that he kept in a opaque bag. And he always poured. He poured a little shot for all of his hasidim, all of his followers. And they say, this legend has it, that the bottle never needed to be refilled. Take it or leave it. But it was known as the arak of the Baba Sali. And that is the second explanation that the Beit Yosef here gives, that they poured from this jug of oil, and it wasn't depleted, it wasn't diminished in any way, the jug remained completely full. And his third answer, which is on page 4, says Beit Yosef number 3 on the top of the page, says on the first night they poured the entire contents of the jug into the menorah. They didn't rely on a miracle. And naturally that oil should have lasted only one night. But in the morning, the menorah was just as full as it was the night before. So it's very similar to the second answer. The second answer was that the oil in the jug, the oil level never went down. Here he's saying that they poured into the cups of the menorah, the jug was empty, but morning came, the flames were still burning and the cups in the menorah were still full. Those are the three explanations that the Beit Yosef gives. There's another explanation given, and this one is by the Chassam Sofer, who passed in the year 1839. And he was the rabbi of a city called Pressburg, which now is known as Bratislava. And I'm excited that I will actually be going to this city this coming summer. So I'm going to be doing a little European trip, Poland, Bratislava and then Budapest. My grandma was from Budapest. So she taught me how to cook. I used to hang out with my grandma in the kitchen before holidays. And she was a real Hungarian cook. She made some of the best food that I've ever had. Don't tell my wife that I said that, please. So this is his answer. He says that the Jews came into the temple. They just defeated the Greek army. And they walk in and the place is, as we said before, a mess. And they really want to light the menorah. And they had to light the menorah that evening. But the issue is, their quandary, their dilemma is, they don't want to light the menorah while there are still all these idols littering the holy temple. So what do they do? And they decide they're going to take the golden menorah from the, what's called in Hebrew as the hecha, that was the inner sanctum. And they're going to bring the golden candelabra, the golden menorah, outside to the courtyard, which was underneath the open sky. And they're going to bring it outdoors. And that's where they're going to light the menorah that night until they have a chance to clean up a little bit and remove some of the offensive items that were brought into this holy place. So they light it outdoors. Keep in mind, Jerusalem, winter time. I've been there. It can get pretty cold. It could be pretty windy. If you try lighting a flame outdoors in Jerusalem, where there's nothing protecting it from the wind, it will likely be extinguished. But the lights of the menorah were not extinguished. They burned strong, they burned firm throughout the night. Interestingly, the Mishnah in Ethics of Our Fathers tells us that there were about 10 miracles that occurred on a daily basis in the temple. One of those miracles is that the altar that they had would have some smoke coming up, a pillar of smoke that would ascend from the altar. And it was outdoors, and you would expect a pillar of smoke that the wind would blow it hither. It would blow it thither. It always went straight up. The wind never affected this pillar of smoke. And that same kind of miracle now transpired with the lights of the menorah. They stayed burning strong throughout the night. And he says, that's the reason why we light an eighth day, was to commemorate the miracle that even on the first night, the lights of the menorah were not extinguished. An additional prayer which is added in to the prayers on Hanukkah is known as the Al Hanisim. We thank God for the miracles and the salvation that He brought for us for Hanukkah. And in that prayer it says, when it speaks of the fact that they lit the menorah, it says that they kindled the lights in your holy courtyard. V'hidliku neirot b'chatzrot kachecha. They lit the candles in the courtyard. And many people ask, well, isn't the menorah normally lit inside? What does it mean they lit it in the courtyard? And the Chatam Sofer uses this theory to explain why it says they lit the menorah in the courtyard. They actually brought it outside, and that's where they lit the menorah, and that's why we have an eighth day to commemorate that miracle, that even on the first night, the lights did not go out. Let's move on to the next source. This is probably my favorite answer of them all. This is from the Pre-Chadash, who lived in the 1600s. And he has a very typical approach. I love this approach. He says, you have a question? I'll ask you another question. That's like really Jewish, you know? He asks another question. His question is that Maimonides states that the date on the Jewish calendar when the Jews finally vanquished the Greek army was the 25th day of the month of the Hebrew month of Kislev. I called it the Hebrew month of Kislev. Actually, it was in Persia that they created those names, that the names come from a Persian origin. I had a friend who in college was majoring in Judaic studies, and he once lost a point in one of his papers for calling it the Jewish month of Kislev, because it's Persian in origin, the name of the month. The fact that we go with the lunar calendar, that already is in the Torah. But the fact that it has these names, the Torah doesn't use these names. It calls it the first month, the second month. These names are actually Persian in origin. So Maimonides states that it was the 25th day of the Persian month of Kislev that we vanquished the Greeks and we entered the temple and we wanted to kindle the lights of the menorah that night. Now, the way the Jewish calendar works is that the beginning of a day is not when the sun goes up in the morning, but it's really from the night before. So for example, Yom Kippur begins with Kol Nidre at the night. Shabbat begins with Friday night, because that's the beginning of a day. So the candles of the menorah were lit in always, I say candles, it wasn't really wax candles, it was oil that was in a little cup. It was lit throughout the night. It burned throughout the night. So if they lit the menorah the night following the 25th of Kislev, what date on the Hebrew calendar is that? That's really Kislev 26, not Kislev 25. So then why is it, asks the Pri Chadash, why is it that we begin the commemoration of Hanukkah on the 25th of Kislev? The miracle really occurred on the 26th of Kislev. Is that a fair question? So he says, to answer both questions, this is the Jewish approach. You ask one question, I'll ask you another, and I'll give you an answer that will satisfy both questions. And the answer that he gives is, you're right. The first day of Hanukkah is not commemorating the miracle of the lights, the fact that the oil burned beyond its natural limits. That's not what the first day of Hanukkah is celebrating. It's celebrating the war victory, the fact that you had a group of poorly trained, poorly armed group of Jewish yeshiva students who took up weapons and fought against the mighty Greek army and they won. That's miraculous. And therefore, the first day of Hanukkah is commemorating that miracle. You're right. The miracle of the lights is only 7 days, and those are the seven subsequent days of Hanukkah, from the 26th of Kislev and on. But the 25th is the day that the battle ended, and we choose that day to commemorate the miracle of the war. That's his answer. Now, I like that. Isn't that good? Here's my follow-up question that troubled me about this answer, as follows. So I understand the miracle of the lights, the fact that the lights burned longer than they should have. The way we commemorate that is by lighting lights. That seems like a very suitable commemoration. Lights burn longer, we're going to go and we're going to kindle a light. But if the first day is for a separate miracle, nothing to do with the lights, it's a separate miracle, the fact that we won. Why did they institute this same method of commemoration of lighting a light? They should do something else, you know, I'm sure they could find something. Why did they choose the same means of commemoration for both miracles? And this question troubled me. And I gave it some thought. And this is what I came up with. In Judaism, we believe that there are two kinds of miracles. There's the miracle like the splitting of the Red Sea, the 10 plagues in Egypt. There's no way really to scientifically explain how it is that the Red Sea split into two, with a path of dry land in between the two sides. The Jews march right out on dry land, and as soon as the Egyptian army enters between those waters, they come crashing down on the Egyptians. That is an outright miracle. You can't explain it any other way. And the same is true with the plague of the frogs and the plague of the blood that happened in Egypt. Those are clear miracles. And then there are other miracles that people might say, well, I have an explanation for that. It's not really a miracle because of this and this factor. I'll give you examples, historical examples. The Six-Day War. You know, most people didn't think, even inside and outside of Israel, people didn't think that the Jews would win that war. President Lyndon Johnson had asked his speechwriters to write a eulogy for the state of Israel because he didn't think they were going to make it. Jews inside of Israel were consumed with this feeling of doom. Am I right? Am I saying this right? There was this desperation, this fear. And then they won. They won. And they didn't only win, but they pushed back their enemies on all sides. They were going to head to Damascus until the Russians threatened to intervene should the Israelis enter Damascus. A stunning victory. Beautiful. Against all odds. Do I believe it was miraculous? Yes. Yes, I do. Could others make the argument and say there was nothing miraculous there? It was good strategy, it was determination, it was good planning. Yes, others can make that same argument, and I have no way of refuting them clearly, but I do believe it was a miracle. Going back to the Second World War, June 6, 1944, the Normandy invasion. And there was this, I remember learning about this in 12th grade. I had a professor in 12th grade. He was a brilliant man. His name was Mr. George. And he knew the history by heart. He used to tell us, we would write it down, who was in every single presidential primary going back 40 years, 50 years. you know, and tell us what the debates were, what the issues were. And I remember him telling us that there was this internal debate among the Nazi hierarchy. They knew that the Allies were going to attack, and they knew that the Allies were going to land somewhere on the French coast. The question was where. And Erwin Rommel, also known as the Desert Fox, he believed strongly that the Allies would land in Normandy. Hitler disagreed. He believed that they would land in a place further north on the French coast called Calais. And because Hitler disregarded what Rommel said, they gave, I'm going to call it minimal fortifications, but it was not as strong as they had in Calais. Normandy was not as well fortified as Calais. As a matter of fact, Erwin Rommel, who was the commander of the German forces on that beach in Normandy, he was away from the front the day of the landing celebrating his wife's birthday. He wasn't there. Are these coincidences or are they miracles? Well, it depends who you ask. I see a divine hand guiding all of those events. I see it as miraculous. Others would disagree. So we have two kinds of miracles. Miracle number one is the supernatural, the display where God says, it's irrefutable, this is me, guys. This is me bringing about something which goes against the course of nature. And then you have the kind where you have to be willing and open to see it in order to believe that it's miraculous. The same is true with the Hanukkah story. There were two miracles that happened. As the Pre-Chadash tells us, there was the miracle of the lights, and there was the miracle of the battle. The miracle of the lights, the fact that no matter how you explain it, did the jug never empty, did it burn and the entire night and the glass was still full, no matter how you chalk it up, there was something supernatural that was clearly supernatural, indisputable, irrefutable. And then there's the miracle on the battlefront. A group of, the numbers were really small. How many Jews were in the Jewish army? Really, really small. The fact that they won, was it a miracle? Yes, I believe so. But others could say they had really good strategy, good tactics, guerrilla warfare. Not as clear cut. And therefore, the sages, when they instituted the commemoration of these two miracles, they wanted to link them. They wanted it to be clear that just as the miracle of the oil is clearly a miracle, the other miracle is also a miracle. And therefore, they chose the same method of commemoration, just the same way that we commemorate by lighting a candle to commemorate that of the menorah. We're going to use the same method for the battle to make it clear that we believe that both of them are equally miracles. Just because you could explain it doesn't mean it's not the hand of God that's bringing it about. And that's my theory. Okay, one or two more answers and then we'll call it a day. An answer that I've seen that I like very much is that sometimes in life we only appreciate unusual occurrences, the wow moments, the everyday comings and goings we take for granted. And therefore, when we're choosing to commemorate something which is beyond the normal, it's important that we take a step back and we appreciate the given. You know, people have this where they sometimes don't appreciate what they have until they don't have it anymore. They just take it as a given. Of course, we have it. And then one day you don't. And then you miss it. And therefore, on Hanukkah, we also say, you know what? The fact that oil burns, the fact that we're able to use, keep in mind, before electricity, the only method of illumination, people would have a little oil lamp in their house. That's how they would be able to see at night. Well, of course, oil burns. Yeah, but that's a gift that God, water doesn't burn. God gave oil the properties that it's able to burn and provide light. You know how depressing it is to be stuck without electricity, darkness? Just with the most recent winds, I think 30,000 Metro Detroit residents were left without power. And I lived in New York during Hurricane Sandy that struck a few years ago. And many people are left without power for a week. It's depressing. It's dark. It's gloomy. It's doomy. It's not fun. And the fact that we have oil that gives us light, we have to take a step back and appreciate that. So you're right. It's not miraculous. It's normal. Oil burns. But when we choose to celebrate and commemorate the miraculous, we also have to take a step back and appreciate that which is a given. That which is normal because it's a gift from God. Interesting side thought to that. There's a custom on a traditional Friday night dinner when people have challah, they'll sometimes take salt and they'll sprinkle a little bit of salt and they'll dip their challah into salt. You know, so why is that? Why do we do that? Are we interested in high blood pressure? You know, that's... And there are several explanations, but one that I heard that I like a lot is that bread, the processes that are necessary to make a loaf of bread, if you go back to the very beginning when you just have this field, and you have to plow the field, and you have to plant the seeds, and you have to water them, and you have to get rid of the weeds, and then eventually you have to harvest, and you have to bundle the wheat, and then you have to thresh where you separate the kernel from the chaff, and then you have to grind the wheat into flour, and eventually you mix it with water when you need it, and then you put it in the oven and you bake it. Many, many steps. And by the time you have that loaf coming out of the oven, you can say, wow, this is me, guys. I'm amazing. I made this challah, and this is all me. Salt, on the other hand, there's two ways. Challah is amazing, by the way. It really is. So I'm not trying to put that down. My wife's challah is fantastic. If any of you ever want to come over for a Friday night dinner, you are invited. All right? Take me up on it, please. So salt, on the other hand, there are two methods how to get salt. Either you mine it from the ground, or you evaporate seawater and you're left with sea salt. But it's clearly not you who made the salt. It's clearly given to you by God. And what we're trying to say is, the same way it's apparent and evident that the salt is a gift of God, it's true, you put a lot of work into making the bread, 100%. But haven't we all had experiences in our lives where we put a lot of effort into an endeavor, into a project, and it was just a disaster? It flopped and it failed. And therefore, we're kind of recognizing that just as the salt is a gift of God, that's evident, that's apparent, the bread as well needed God's blessing in order for us to come to this moment where we could cut open that steaming hot loaf of challah and enjoy it. And therefore we put the bread with the salt. Just like the salt is very clear, so too we try to give the same message for the bread. I'm going to close with the final answer, and that could be found on the last page. And this answer is so early, it even predates the life of the Beis Yosef who asked the question. So you see that this question had been a very early one. And this is from the Sefer HaEshkol. And he says, you know what? The fact that they were able to find a flask of oil in the first place is something which requires our recognition. Now, that's amazing. The Greeks made it their vendetta to defile every single flask of oil. They tried, and there were many of them, and they entered and they ransacked the temple. The fact that there was one left is something that requires commemoration. And he says, that's the reason why we have that eighth day of Hanukkah. And I'll just share with you, and I'll close with that, the message that I've learned from that. You know, sometimes, of course, we have the flask of oil. How long could it last for? It could only last for one day. Okay, so there's 7 days of miracle. Sometimes we need to step back and appreciate the fact that we have something. Like, I'll just give you an example. Sometimes we bask in the talents and skills that our children have, or our grandchildren. We quell a little bit. You know, oh, my grandchildren, you wouldn't believe what they can do. You know, and they have talents, and many of them have talents, incredible skills and talents. But what about the fact that we have grandchildren? Isn't that an incredible blessing? Isn't that a blessing that not everyone merits to have? Our spouse, if we have one. You know, we look at the talents, but things they have above and beyond the other people. And I could list you a litany, a long list of the talents and skills and wonders of my wife. But what about the fact that I have a wife? Isn't that an incredible blessing in and of itself? You know, they say that the Hebrew term that's used for finding a wife is to find. Like you've discovered something. And we believe, I believe this at least, that there's a predetermination. What's that? Yes, if you find a wife, you found good. That's the way they describe finding a wife. And I believe that there's this predestination where I was meant to be married to my wife. And that means out of the millions of women out there, the fact that it was orchestrated and brought about that I should even find her, that's something which is incredible. And that's the message of this eighth day of Hanukkah. The fact that they found the flask, that's something which they need to take a step back and appreciate. Because sometimes we have to appreciate just the very things that we have. And then we can move on to the extras. A very happy Hanukkah to you all. Thank you for coming.